Now move on to questions to the Minister of Employment and Learning. And can I inform members before we begin that questions 1, 4 and 13 have been withdrawn within the agreed time frame and protocols. And I call Mr Paul Givan.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Question number 2.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Recent estimates by Ulster University's Economic Policy Centre show that a reduction to 12.5% from April 2017 could lead to an increase in employment of 38,000 jobs by 2033 compared to today. In order to prepare for such a lower corporation tax environment, I commissioned research which considered the impact that a lower rate would have on the demand for skills, labour and innovation capacity. That research set out the importance of developing our skills base and the employability of our people in a lower corporation tax environment, highlighting in particular the importance of strong skills in STEM areas, management and leadership, literacy and numeracy and employability skills if we are to capture the full benefits of a lower rate. These are issues that the Department is already working to address and are central themes within the overarching skills strategy. However, although the Department is already on the right path, what the research shows is that it will need to go further to address the quantum of skills required under that type of scenario. Therefore, my Department has developed a draft action plan to prepare the way and to put in place robust measures so we can move swiftly in the event that a rate is determined.
And for supplement.
And can I thank the Minister for that response? He's touched on the need to ensure that we have the appropriate skills to pick up the type of jobs that would be generated through a reduction in corporation tax. Has his department given any consideration to what further jobs could be created if we had a corporation rate at a better advantage to that of our neighbours in the Republic of Ireland?
Well, I don't think that the context of the actions that we need to do will be that much different in the context of whether we're talking about a 12.5% or a lower rate than 12.5%. And while it's not my individual responsibility as a minister to set the rate, my views as part of a collective executive would be that I think it would be foolish for us to try to have a race to the bottom of trying to undercut the rate in the Republic of Ireland, because I think they simply would just move to match us. I think there are advantages in having a common regime on the island, and then we can both compete based upon our other strong attributes in our respective jurisdictions. But in terms of the members stressing the importance of skills, I would stress that we have to make further investments in skills, and it's important that the full House understands the importance that if we are to go down the route of lower level of corporation tax, that cannot be successful in a vacuum. We have to invest in skills. A standstill in terms of what we're doing isn't good enough, but we're actually at the current moment in time de-investing from a lot of our skills drivers, so we're actually taking the wrong action if we are supposed to be planning ahead for what should be something that would give the economy a major boost here.
Well, Mr. Patsy
McGlohan. Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. Could I ask the Minister, given the experience of geographic clustering in the Republic subsequent to the reduction in corporation tax, will the Minister be working with businesses and indeed other executive colleagues to ensure that the business growth isn't concentrated in the Greater Belfast area to the exclusion of other areas outside Glengormley?
Well, first of all, can I just put on record my appreciation to the member and indeed his committee for the piece of work that they're doing through their current inquiry into what is necessary in terms of the supporting drivers. And no doubt the issue in terms of the distribution of job growth will be one of the issues that they will be looking to consider. It's important to stress that a lower rate, again with the proviso that we invest further in the right supporting mechanisms, will stand to benefit the economy of Northern Ireland as a whole. And while it is right that we do look to the distribution of jobs, it's also important that we encourage labour mobility in what is still a reasonably small, compact region. We can encourage jobs to go to different parts of Northern Ireland, but equally we need to be realistic that we cannot seek to micromanage what decisions the companies are making, and they will make their decisions based upon other sound economic rationale. So yes, we can do what we can to encourage that to happen, but it's important that members are also realistic that we're not here to direct where investment happens. Let's get into Northern Ireland and make it work for the benefit of everyone.
Commissioner Danny Kinahan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Northern Ireland is ranked behind London just behind London for FDI, and that's really due to the calibre of our graduates. But does the Minister believe that there will be better support for graduates with a Department of Economy rather than a Department of Employment and Learning?
Well, first of all, let me say I very much welcome the move to form a new department of the economy. That's not to diminish the work that has been done by my own department, nor indeed the work of my colleague, the Minister for Enterprise, Trade and Investment, and also Invest Northern Ireland as separate entities. All of those bodies have worked very closely together, and indeed the leadership in all of those organisations have worked very closely together as well. But no doubt that there are some degree of inefficiencies from having separate distinctive bodies, and bringing all of the economic policy levers and delivery mechanisms under one roof is the logical thing to be doing. So I very much welcome what is the creation of a brand new department which will be greater than some of its individual parts.
Sir Jim Mallister.
Does the Minister agree that the only certainty attaching to the devolution of corporation tax is a huge year-on-year reduction running into hundreds of millions of pounds on the Buck grant, and the Minister has some experience of the pressures that brings? And does he draw any caution from the fact that at the very time when corporation tax is promised to be being devolved, that one of the largest manufacturers in my constituency, JTI Gallagher's, are choosing in spite of that to leave? And is that not a warning that corporation tax is far from the salvation for our economy?
Well, I think there's a number of points I would make in that regard. I mean, first of all, yes, I mean, a lower level of corporation tax is going to be a major financial commitment for the executive. I do believe that it will be of benefit, and it can create jobs and indeed and create more wealth, which will benefit our society as a whole. That is by no means certain, of course, and that's why it's so important that we don't try to do this in a vacuum. That is, that we continue to invest in other economic drivers. What I would say to the member is that if we seek to fund a lower level of corporation tax by continuing along the current path of cuts to economic drivers, including our colleges and universities, then the lower level of corporation tax will be counterproductive. It will not produce the results that we are expecting. But if we do it properly, then it will be successful. We are seeing, for example, the Republic of Ireland sticking by its lower level of corporation tax through some very deep, challenging financial and economic times over the past 7 or 8 years, and we should take very strong lessons from that. We should also be very clear that all of the business organisations in Northern Ireland are very clear in their support for this type of intervention. Again, we should listen very strongly to those voices. The final thing I would say is that it's important that we also recognise that a lower level corporation tax will not work exactly a uniform way across all types of business. For example, there are companies here at present that perhaps do not have major profit centres for whom a lower level won't be of huge relevance. Other companies may, for other reasons, wish to de-invest from Northern Ireland and locate elsewhere. But at the same time, we will bring in more companies to Northern Ireland under a lower rate and see more of our existing companies grow than we will in terms of those companies for whom it doesn't actually benefit directly, or for whom there are other factors in terms of the decisions they make.
Thank you. And I call Ms. Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question number 3.
My department recently invited applications for funding to the Northern Ireland European Social Fund programme 2014-20. Members will be familiar with the background to the issues regarding the programme. Phase 1 of the assessment has been completed and applicants notified of the outcome. A total of 15 appeals from Phase 1 have also been heard by an appeals panel and the outcomes notified to applicants. The panel upheld appeals for 3 applications which have now been assessed by the assessment panel. All applications that progressed to Phase 2 have now been assessed by assessment panels, and all applicants were notified of the panel's decisions on the 26th of March. Those applicants that have been unsuccessful were afforded an opportunity to receive details on the outcome of their application. In addition, those applicants were also afforded an opportunity for appeal. An initial date for appeals was amended to the 10th of April due to a number of applicants seeking an extension and the Easter holidays. 27 appeals were received by the closing date, and these will be reviewed by an appeals panel. Applicants that have been successful have been offered funding from the 1st of April 2015. As previously advised, the programme was heavily oversubscribed in terms of the number of applications received and funding available. 134 applications were originally received, and the total value of those applications exceeded the budget available. 65 projects worth £102 million were offered funding from the fund over a three-year period from the 1st of April 2015 to the 31st of March 2018. Over this initial 3 years of funding, the projects will assist over 42,000 individuals to fulfil their potential by providing them with better skills and better job prospects to take forward the steps into employment. Additionally, the programme will provide assistance to over 2,300 families.
I call Ms Cameron for a supplement.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer. Can I ask if the Minister can confirm what support his department intends to provide to those 220 people who will lose their jobs as a result of the debacle around applications to the European Social Fund?
Well, I'm not quite sure what context the member is using the term debacle, and it would be useful if members are going to be throwing out terms like that casually to actually explain what they mean in that regard. But let me be very clear. This is an open competitive process for funding. No organisation was guaranteed funding as part of this process. Those organisations that had funding under the previous rounds were not guaranteed the continuation of funding. Fresh applications were being made. Every organisation was having their application assessed on their merits and a rank order developed in that regard. As part of that process, there will be some organisations who will gain and some who will lose, and very sadly there will be occasions where jobs are lost if organisations feel that that is the only path open to them. But at the same token, a greater number of jobs will be created in terms of the package overall, and it's worth reminding members that the ESF package for Northern Ireland is actually significantly greater than the previous round between 2007 and 2013, so we're actually able to do more overall in Northern Ireland, but the distribution of how the funds will be allocated will be different from the pattern under the previous round because we're considering a fresh round of applications.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The Minister referred to the assessment panels a number of times. For the sake of clarity to the House, could the Minister provide what training was given to the assessment panel members and indeed if all the panel members attended that training?
Well, again, we have this theme of seeking to undermine the qualifications of the individuals who are conducting these assessments. These people are all experienced individuals within the public sector. There's a rigour to this process, and whenever the member asks questions about training, there seems to be this insinuation that the people doing this are not actually fit to do the job. Let me again stress to the House, this process has been handled by people who are qualified in terms of the tasks that are being asked of them, and they have conducted the tasks that they have been asked to do in a fair and impartial way.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I think, Minister, the last question time you yourself said that you had to intervene to put some integrity back into the process, so it hasn't been without blame in a sense. But, Principal Deputy Speaker, I wonder could the Minister acknowledge that the community and voluntary sector in particular have had a splendid role to play over the last number of years in relation to providing training and employment opportunities for people, particularly women, people with disabilities and older people. So therefore, if there are particular sectors which have lost out in this round, will the Minister be widening his net in any future call for funding to allow those sectors to be better represented in any successful application of the criteria?
Well, again, I wish the member would clarify where she feels the particular sectors have lost out. Certainly we can all think of certain organisations that may have lost out, but there are a number of projects across all the sectors that the member has referenced to that have been awarded funding in terms of the announcement made towards the end of March. The community and voluntary sector in Northern Ireland is going through a difficult time, and indeed the member's own minister has actually scaved his way through the community voluntary sector that supports the environment in Northern Ireland. I have taken the approach of seeking to work very closely with the community voluntary sector. We've made clear that we value the contribution that they make. Again, I stress that we have a bigger pot of European Social Fund available. That has been distributed in a fair and impartial way, but as part of that process, there will be some organisations that can be perceived as winning and others that are perceived as losing. That is part and parcel of an open and competitive process. But what this is about is ensuring that we actually are funding the best projects available to us that meet the operational objectives that are set out in the operational programme, something indeed that was agreed by the executive as a whole. That is there to ensure that we're actually doing the best with the money available to us to create the biggest impact for the people of Northern Ireland, especially those who are most disadvantaged.
Gary, and Commissioner Pat Ramsey.
Question 5, Mr. Speaker.
My department recently completed a review of youth training in Northern Ireland for 16 to 24-year-olds. This comprehensive review included an in-depth examination of international best practice in youth training, including the provision of mentoring. This research indicated that one-to-one support for a young person while they're in the workplace is vital, with dual mentoring in both work and training being identified as a key ingredient in successful vocational education and training schemes. Consequently, based upon the international best practice identified, the review of youth training duly proposed that the provision of a workplace mentor be a key component of the proposed new youth training offer to assist young people to complete their training and progress into higher level options. As a minimum, it concluded that every young person in training should have a named individual in the workplace that is responsible for their development. The review consultation has recently concluded, with a new strategy for youth training expected to be finalised in the coming weeks. Following this, it is intended that elements of the proposals, including workplace mentoring, will be piloted.
Mr. Ramsey, for some.
Thank you, Speaker, and I welcome the Minister's response. What triggered this question is, for the record, I chair the All-Party Group on Learning Disability. And parents and groups representing that sector are deeply worried that we do know the facts that somebody with a learning disability is 4 times less likely to secure employment. Could the Minister give us an assurance that more skills and more advisors will be available to ensure that those most vulnerable in our community will have access to those same mentoring facility? Because in my own constituency, Ardnessy Special Needs Campus is working very thoroughly on this under the model of good practice.
I'm very happy to give the member that reassurance. It's also important to read both the new strategy on apprenticeships and the forthcoming strategy on youth training in conjunction with another piece of work that we're conducting in the department, which is the development of a disability skills and employment strategy. And we are seeking to make additional investments in terms of mentoring to support people with disabilities, a range of disabilities through a whole range of different interventions in terms of the training and employment environment. And indeed, the concept of workplace mentor is something that is relevant not just to those people with identified disability, but indeed to other young people as they work through the system. I think it is something where we have learned very keenly from international best practice, and I think it stands in contrast to maybe as to how developed that is in terms of the current system that members will be more familiar with.
Gowan, Commissioner Edmund Poots.
Question 6, Mr. Speaker.
A stable and globally competitive higher education sector in Northern Ireland is fundamental to future economic prosperity. In order to compete successfully on the global stage, teaching must be of the highest quality, the learning environment flexible and supportive, and the research-based dynamic and impactful. To ensure this, the financial sustainability of the sector is crucial. However, the financial position of our higher education sector now finds itself in... The financial position our higher education sector finds itself in now is eroding due to the cuts that we have seen in terms of budgets, not least in terms of the most recent budget that was struck by the executive. There's already a funding gap with our higher education institutions and their counterparts elsewhere in the UK to the tune of £1,000 to £2,500 per student. And in terms of university research funding, the annual deficit now sits at around £9.2 million per annum. The deficit that already existed has only been compounded further by the budget settlement, and the higher education sector is now facing a further reduction of £16.1 million in the forthcoming financial year. Some 38% of our higher education sector's income comes from grants, mostly provided by my department. We cannot continue to expect our higher education sector to meet local skills needs, generate wealth and job creation, and compete on the global stage for staff and students while continuing to diminish our level of investment. It is my intention to have a wider discussion about the future funding of higher education locally. Therefore, I will be launching a wider debate as to how Northern Ireland can support a financially sustainable and internationally competitive higher education sector.
And a supplementary, Mr. Evan Pitts.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the Minister recognise that the pincer movement on the universities of capped tuition fees and reduced funding from his department as a result of the budget completely undermines the great leadership that we have in our universities and their attempts to ensure the quality of education? And would he agree with me that the consequence of spending the money on welfare, as opposed to things like higher education, will ultimately lead to more people remaining in poverty, more students having to go to England and other places to receive the appropriate qualifications, and that the competitiveness of our universities will decline as a result?
Well, I concur with the member in the main in terms of the comments that he has made. Our universities are in a very perilous state at present. They have had their ability to generate income restricted by the decision of the executive to freeze tuition fees. There is cross-party support for that, but we haven't seen the same level of investment in terms of revenue to meet the shortfall and also to meet the level of investment happening elsewhere in these islands. We've also now a situation where that structural problem has now been compounded by further budget cuts. And while the situation that the executive finds itself in relation to the budget is in part explained by the decisions or non-decisions around welfare, there are other factors as well in terms of a number of decisions that the executive have taken or not taken, including addressing division in our society, which are further compounding the situation. This will have major impacts in terms of our ability to provide the skills needed by our economy, and I am deeply worried by the path that we're currently on. And indeed, if we have a lower level of corporation tax, those pressures are going to be even more acute. And the member is quite right also to identify that this will impact upon individuals. We will shortly see the universities, very regrettably, having no choice but to remove a number of places. That will either force some of our young people to go to Great Britain to study. Not only will they have to face higher level fees, but the likelihood is they won't return to our Northern Ireland economy. Other young people may find themselves priced out entirely from higher education and simply not take that opportunity. And those skills will be lost to our economy as well. And indeed, the life opportunities of those young people will be severely compromised.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the Minister for his answer thus far. Excuse me. Given the budget that the Minister is forced to work with, that will bizarrely result in us cutting student numbers when we're trying to grow an economy, what impact does the Minister think that will have on his widening participation strategy in terms of higher education?
Well, as a member will be aware, one of the steps we have taken is to give the universities a little bit more flexibility in terms of how they meet the targets that we have set for them in terms of widening participation. So they have been able to redirect some of their investments towards protecting the frontline places, but they've also given an assurance that they will not seek to diminish. Indeed, they will seek to improve upon the strong track record that we have. But ultimately, the biggest threat to widening participation is going to be the loss of places. So if we don't actually have the places for people to access, then we will see problems with participation. And that will disproportionately affect people who are coming from the more marginalised and vulnerable groups within our society. So again, this reinforces the importance of a solid settlement for our higher education institutions and indeed our wider skills environment in terms of the budget for the 16-17 period and beyond.
Thank you. And a comment from Mr. Roy Biggs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Our people and their skills are our greatest asset when attracting new employers to Northern Ireland. I'm sure the Minister would agree. But has the Minister made any assessment of how these cuts in university places is being received globally in terms of attracting new employment and new skills and new bases and new opportunities for our young people?
Well, we have to have a certain degree of care in terms of how we say this and put this across, but in very simple terms, yes, I mean, this is having an impact. It's one thing to say that all we need to do is to rebalance the investment in higher education, focus more in terms of STEM subjects, and that is an important thing to do in its own right. But a situation where we're actively de-investing in higher education, where we're removing places, and indeed every place is of relevance to economy and the provision of higher level skills and consequently economic growth, that sends out a very worrying message to potential investors. So as much as we will seek to attract investors by saying, look, we're on the brink of having a lower level of corporation tax, if at the same time they are seeing question marks being raised over our ability to invest in skills, then they are going to be asking even more searching questions and potentially even looking elsewhere in terms of their investment decisions if they don't have the confidence and the certainty that we can produce for them. We have done extremely well over the past number of years, but that situation is not sustainable if we are going to continue down the same road that we're on at present in terms of cutting our skills budgets.
Thank you. And I come to Mr. Cahill Boylan.
Cash, Deborah Shockley, the whole question number 7, please.
As my department does not hold this information, officials have received confirmation from each of the universities that they do not set a minimum target for course directors to include e-books as part of the core reading material for undergraduate degrees. Students are therefore free to choose their own preferred method of accessing reading material. Universities are responsible for their own policies and procedures, including course delivery. There is no requirement for them to set targets in relation to the medium of delivery.
Mr. Boylan for supplementary.
I concur and thank the Minister for his answer, but given, Minister, that e-books are more cost-effective, would he consider setting a target to assist the pupils with their study?
Well, I'm happy to encourage the universities to go down this route, and they're very clearly aware of the very tight financial situation that they find themselves in as a consequence of the current funding cuts that are being passed on, not least in terms of the attitude his own party has taken to welfare at present. It is ultimately for universities to run their own provision. It's not the job of the department to micromanage exactly how they go about that. And I fear us setting a target, I think, would be a disproportionate way in terms of interfering, where we end up with the department actually running universities rather than that universities get on and actually do the job that we actually want them to do for the economy as a whole.
I call Joanne Dobson for supplement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I ask the Minister what additional support has he provided to the Open University since its devolution?
Well, the Open University is very much part of the higher education family in Northern Ireland, and they are now receiving their funding direct from my department. They obviously are under a degree of financial pressure as well. In some ways, they are perhaps slightly more adaptable in the sense that they, with their part-time provision and also the nature of some of the new opportunities emerging through, for example, our apprenticeship strategy, in particular higher-level apprenticeships, to take up some of those opportunities. They also obviously have a much stronger tradition in terms of virtual learning than maybe more of the more traditional universities in terms of the approach that's taken to learning. So again, they're well placed to take advantage of new developments in higher education, such as MOOCs.
Now comes Sir Oliver McMullen.
I can call you ever a hot question.
The Higher Education Funding Review commenced in September 2013. In December 2014, I decided that it would not be appropriate to undertake a consultation of the funding review amid the uncertainties about my department's future budgets. The consultation was therefore put on hold until the budget settlement for 15-16 became clearer. The higher education sector is facing a one-year budget reduction of 8.4% to teaching and research grants. This equates to a reduction of £16.1 million. This has led to serious questions over the future financial sustainability of higher education, which I don't believe can be addressed through the limited scope of the higher education funding review. Although my department will now be taking forward certain aspects of the review separately, I have identified the need for a wider discussion with all stakeholders about how Northern Ireland can support a financially sustainable and internationally competitive sector. The work that has been undertaken in regard to the Higher Education Funding Review will be crucial in informing and facilitating this wider discussion. With regard to student finance, I will shortly be launching a consultation on part-time and postgraduate taught student support. This will ensure that any policies relating to new student support package for part-time and postgrad learners will be in place for the academic year 2016-17. Student finance has long been a crucial enabler of higher education study, and I want to ensure accessibility into and through higher education for all types of learners. Also, during my discussions with NUS-USI at their annual conference, representations were made on potential modifications to the frequency of student support payments. I'm happy to explore this issue in more detail, and the first step of this process will be a public consultation exercise.
Sorry that we're out of time, and I'll really take your supplementary. That ends the period for listed questions, and we now move on to topical questions, and I call Mr. Declan McAleer.
Could the Minister give his assessment of the success of the Assured Skills programme?
Assured Skills has been an outstanding success, and indeed I think Assured Skills can be viewed as almost a unique contribution in terms of the approach to inward investment relative to different approaches that are taken around the world. It's very much based around working with companies around addressing their very particular skills requirements. We know we can attract companies in Northern Ireland based upon the quality of our workforce and our emerging people coming through colleges and universities in a general sense, but often companies will want that assurance that we can provide the very particular skills that they require for their businesses to be a success. I'm pleased to say that we have now moved from Assured Skills being a pilot programme over the past number of years to be mainstream provision. And in particular, as we look ahead to a lower level of corporation tax, the work that we do through Assured Skills will become even more important.
And I call Mr. McAleer for supplementary.
From his engagement with the business and industries and various companies, does the Minister believe that the Assured Skills programme is essential for attracting inward investment?
Very much so, and the member will note from the large number of investments that we have seen over the past 12 months in particular how closely my department has worked with Invest Northern Ireland to make those a reality, and we have offered Assured Skills programmes in a considerable number of those particular investments. A lot of the feedback from companies is that that type of intervention is critical in terms of their decision making, and again that's something that we have to build upon in terms of future years.
Okay, and I call Mr. Chris Little.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I ask the Minister for an update on the implementation of the apprenticeship strategy and his work to ensure parity of esteem for vocational training in Northern Ireland?
Well, our apprenticeship strategy, as the member knows, was launched in the Assembly in June 2014. We are phasing the introduction of the new strategy through between then and September of 2016. Work is well underway in terms of the developments of a number of pilots in terms of higher level apprenticeships, and we also have in place now an interim strategic advisory forum, and I'm pleased that Brian Keating has assumed the chair of that at our meeting at the end of March. Over the next number of months, that group will be working in terms of a number of particular aspects around, for example, legislation, and also how we can better encourage uptake from employers in terms of new opportunities. We also have a successful bid in terms of the Change Fund for £7.5 million to support both apprenticeships and youth training over the forthcoming 12 months. Again, that's a valuable asset there to develop what should be an absolutely critical investment in terms of delivering both for our young people and also ensuring that companies are getting the very direct skills that they require to be a success in Northern Ireland.
A little for a supplement.
Thank the Minister for his update. I find it encouraging the work that is being done in regard to apprenticeships. Can I ask the Minister what the main opportunities and challenges are going to be in coming months and whether any progress has been made on companies working together to deliver apprenticeships in a joined-up fashion?
Well, I'm certainly pleased that we are seeing a number of sector partnerships emerging to date. We have sector partnerships in place in terms of the IT sector, engineering, and also food and drink manufacturing. We've also seen some very strong work happening in terms of emerging apprenticeships in terms of life sciences and also finance and accountancy, and shortly, hopefully, we will see sector partnerships in those areas. I think it's important that we encourage businesses to come forward and to create opportunities in terms of apprenticeships. It's important that businesses are in the driving seat in terms of creating fresh opportunities. It's not about the state here trying to second-guess where apprenticeships should be created. It's about companies themselves identifying their future training requirements. So the real challenge is to ensure that we can actually keep up and meet the expectations of businesses, and also that we can do more to encourage our young people to consider apprenticeships as being a legitimate pathway, which is on a par with some of the more traditional pathways through, for example, university. Both are good ways of achieving higher level skills, and we need to ensure we have a balanced approach in terms of our economy.
Thank you. And Mr. Chris Hazard is not in his place, and Mr. Dahi Mackay is not in his place. So I call Ms. Bronwyn McGahan.
Can I ask the Minister if his department would consider holding a jobs fair in Dungannon district, in particular Caleisha Community Centre, the heartland of a rural area and an area that has experienced high levels of immigration?
Happy for my officials to engage with the member and to consider what she has proposed in that regard. We are committed to holding a number of job fairs in different locations across Northern Ireland. What we do want to see is that there is a critical mass of employers who are willing to use that particular type of forum to engage with those who are unemployed or looking to change jobs so we can make the event a success. We have had run a number of successful job fairs in different places over the past number of months, and the feedback to those has been very good. So we're more than happy to look into to what the member has proposed.
Yeah, and for supplement.
Okay, Gurmi Agadan, and I thank the Minister for his very positive response. Minister, given that economic inactivity is the highest, especially in rural areas, you know, would the Minister agree with me that such an event in the heartland of a rural area is an important step in tackling unemployment in rural areas?
Absolutely. A few weeks ago I was visiting a jobs fair in Clawdy, again, where we're focusing on very much around engagement in terms of rural areas. So in terms of the approach that we are taking as a department, this is not a one-size-fits-all where we're doing big events, whether it's in Belfast or Derry, and expecting people to come in there. We will show a degree of flexibility in terms of accommodating people in terms of different types of settings. That includes the urban-rural split.
And I call Ms. Michaela Boyle.
Can I ask the Minister for an update on the ongoing work to develop the North West Regional College in Strabane, Gormoggett?
Well, at this stage, I think it's clear to say to members that there's no immediate plans in relation to capital investment in terms of Strabane. We are committed to working with North West College to ensure that they are delivering a balanced curriculum across their geographical area. And if there are particular questions or points that the member wishes to make in relation to what should or shouldn't be provided in Strabane, I'm more than happy to take those on board.
Call Ms. Michaela Boyle for.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for the answer. Minister, would there be any intention in your department of increasing the number of places on offer in Strabane? Is that an area that you would be willing to look at, Gormoggett?
Well, That is very much something for, again, North West Regional College to consider themselves. It's for them and the other five colleges to consider their own curriculum offer and also the distribution of that offer across the different campuses. It's important that members appreciate that the role of government here is not to micromanage how we deliver further education the same way that we don't seek to micromanage the delivery of higher education. That's why we have colleges, that's why they have their own boards of governors and the principals and staff that work to those boards. That's the essence of pluralism. But if the member has particular concerns around what is is or is not being provided in Strabane. I'm certainly happy to take that on board and certainly speak to the powers that be within North West College. But ultimately, these are decisions for them to take, but we can seek to express views to them. That's perfectly legitimate.
And I call Mr. Robin Swan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The Minister recently announced £108,000 towards the NEET strategy forum. Can he update the House on how he thinks that will be spent?
Well, it's important to recognise, first of all, that we are going through some difficult times in terms of our ability to deliver the Pathways to Success strategy, which is the executive strategy for dealing with NEETs. The forum itself has been very successful in terms of engaging a range of different sectors within the community and voluntary sector in terms of best practice and sharing best practice. It's also created our ability to engage in a more structured manner with young people. And in particular, the voices of young people were very clear in terms of advocacy that we should seek to have a continuation of the NEETs forum. And that's the type of work I would expect that we will be able to continue, albeit in a slightly more constricted format, given the reduction of available resources to us. But nonetheless, in terms of our ability to find resources, I regard this as being a priority in terms of our continued ability to make some investments in terms of working with those who are marginalised from the labour market, in particular young people.
Mr. Swan.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his explanation. One of the recommendations from the previous forum was the continuation of the Pathways to Success Educational Maintenance Allowance. The Minister withdrew that within a couple of days of actually assigning the £108,000 to the NEET Strategy Forum. Can he tell me how those two balance up? Because if he's removed the Educational Maintenance Allowance from those young people who are actually on the Pathways to Success programme, they're actually in need and more in need of that supplement and that provision.
Well, first of all, I think the member should be aware, and I know he is aware, that my department had a significant budget allocated to it for investing in the Pathways to Success strategy. That money came to an end on the 31st of March 2015. Had we been in different financial circumstances, it would have been my hope and indeed expectation that a similar amount of money would have been found by the executives to continue that work. All of that money is now dried up. Now, we have seen a migration of some of the, for example, organisations who worked on the Collaboration and Innovation Fund in terms of seeking funding under the European Social Fund. Sadly, it's my view that at present we weren't in the position to continue with the training allowance. That automatically came to an end with the end of the funding. In terms of limited resources available to us, it was my judgment that the continuation of the NEETS forum, in terms of the money involved to make that a success, was going to be a more productive use of resources. That's not to diminish or take away from the importance of the training allowance. And I've asked my officials to continue to look in terms of existing, albeit diminished, budgets to see if there's a means by which we can have a continuation of a training allowance for young people on some of the schemes that are out there. But that work is still underway, and as the member appreciates, budgets are now incredibly tight, and we're having to make a lot of very difficult decisions, and we have to make sure that we use resources in the most efficient and effective way possible.
Grumil Mayagat Kankolia, August the Kesha Gumarinara, Fween Kist Social Ta Orapak. Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. And I'd like to ask the Minister if he can say which projects in the Newry and Armagh constituency have progressed to the next stage under the European Social Fund.
Well, what I'll say to the member, in terms of the press release that we issued on the 26th of March, there's a comprehensive list of the organisations that have been offered funding, and I would encourage the member to peruse that. There will be some organisations that are particular to that particular sub-regional area in Northern Ireland. Other schemes may have a wider application but will still impact upon that part of the world. There's also a number of appeals that are still in the process, as I mentioned earlier on. So that situation may change if some of those appeals are successful in moving some particular proposals within the framework of which we're actually making funding offers to organisations.
Mr. Dominic Bradley for a quick
Well, can I ask the Minister how he will ensure that an appropriate geographical spread of funding will be achieved?
Well, we have conducted some analysis of the current funding decisions that we have made, and I'm satisfied that there is a fair distribution across the different parliamentary assembly constituencies in Northern Ireland. That's not entirely uniform, it can't be, given the nature of the process underway. It also reflects, I think, a lot of work that was conducted by officials in terms of the different roadshows across Northern Ireland that took place in the autumn of last year, where we were raising awareness of the opportunities to bid. Again, that was all solid work that was happening to ensure that we, as far as possible, could ensure a fair regional balance in terms of funding offers that were being made.
That ends the question. Thank you, Minister. The period for questions. We now return.